right. So every other Thursday, we will talk about issues that you all care about, from pop culture to politics to racial inequalities to gender issues and everything in between. So I am joined by five phenomenal teams from the DC, Maryland, Virginia, Hawaii area. And you'll get to know them a little bit more every other Thursday. But for now, why don't our co-hosts introduce themselves? So tell us your name, where you're from, and where you attend school. So let's start with Antonio, because you're first on my vision board.
Okay, my name is Antonio LeBron. My age is 15. I attend Sarasville High School, and I enjoy it here. I'm in Maryland, and I love Maryland. So,
all right. Hey, Antonio. Margaret.
Hi, I'm Margaret Ayipor. I'm 15 years old, and I attend Elizabeth Seton High School.
Yay, Margaret. Jordan.
Hi, I'm Jordan. I'm 18, and I go to Kapolei High School.
Thank you, Jordan. Naye.
I'm Naye, and I'm 15, and I attend Girls Global Academy High School.
Welcome, Naye. And then Aisha.
Hello, everyone. My name is Aisha. I'm 15, and I'm a sophomore at Parkdale High School.
All right. So you all will be our co-hosts for the next year. And so our audience members, you'll get to know them more. You'll get to know their personalities, what makes them tick, what makes them laugh, and all of that good stuff. So I wanted to also invite anyone who is listening. If you are here and you want to jump in the conversation, you can use the chat at any time to add on to anything that we're talking about, to ask any of our co-hosts a question, because this is a space not for us to just talk at you, but for all of us to talk together. So I wanted to first start things off by setting some ground rules for the conversation. Because we will be talking about a variety of different topics, we all thought it was important for us to decide and to think about what makes a good conversation when talking with each other, meaning each other here on the podcast, but also when we talk with each other outside of the podcast, on the streets, in our school, in our classrooms. So the first question that I wanted to ask our co-host is, what are your rules? What are things that you think work for conversations with each other and those who are listening? Antonia, how about you get us started?
All right, so a good conversation is getting a response, is responding. For me, I don't want to just talk and have them only hear what I'm saying, but I also want them to tell me what they agree with or if they don't agree, so that I know what else we can talk about or what else can be fixed. So for me, it would have to be a response for a good conversation.
Okay. Response. Mm-hmm. Margaret, what is one thing that you would think of as a good conversation?
Someone who's listening and paying attention to what I'm saying, basically.
Okay. Jordan?
I would say respect is of the utmost importance, because you have to be able to respect each other and to really understand when something gets uncomfortable for the other person.
Mm-hmm. That's good.
Naye, what are you thinking? Naye, are you there?
Yes, I would say agree to disagree. Like, make sure that, like, even if you agree to something or disagree with something, that you still, like they said, respectful. And if you don't agree with something, don't just, like, be rude about it. Just be like, okay, I disagree with that. Just kind of say calmly and, like, respectfully.
Okay, so I've heard listening, responding, agreeing to disagree. Aisha, what would you add to top this all off?
To top it all off, I would say just being open-minded in general. You know, you might not always agree with the person you're talking to. So the best way to have an effective conversation is just to understand both views and be open-minded.
All right. I love it. And all of those points we're definitely going to apply to today's conversation. And so the topic is placing democracy in the hands of our youth, changing the legal voting age. So a little bit of context to get the conversation going. As we're coming off an election season and President-elect Joe Biden and President-elect Vice President Kamala Harris are set to be sworn in January, we wanted to use this episode as an opportunity to reflect back on the elections that happened this November and also look forward to the future of what does voting look like for our youth. So all of our co-hosts were not technically eligible to vote in this elections, which made this a very interesting conversation. And so we wanted to hear their thoughts on lowering the voting age in the future as a way to make change. So before I open it up for them to share their thoughts on if this is something that they would be in favor in or against, I wanted to give you some facts to think about as you make your decision. So after the election, it was shown from a research study that voter turnout increased by 8% in this elections from the young people from 18 to 29. So that means from 18 to 29, more voters in the younger age range voted this year than they did in 2016. So that's one piece of fact and information to kind of keep in mind in this lowering the voting age. And the second fact that I didn't know, but I learned, is that the voting age before it was 18, it was actually 21. And so it was lowered 4 years before this new now voting age that we know as being 18. So given those two facts and just your own thoughts on voting and using that as a way to make change, if you were of age to vote this year, would you have voted and why? So let's start off with that question. If you were 18 in this 2020 election, would you have voted and why?
Can I go first? Okay, so I wouldn't have voted if I turned 18 this year, mainly because I wouldn't feel like I was ready to make a decision like that. And without knowing what actually goes on behind the scenes in the political world, I don't think I'd be ready to just jump and then, you know, decide who's going to lead our country for the next 4 years. So personally, I would not be able to vote.
Antonio.
So if I were to turn 18 this year, before all that began, I would vote. I would vote because every vote, even though it seems like it doesn't matter, every vote matters. It can change it for the bad or it can change it for a greater cause. So I would have voted because I know that every vote needs to be where it needs to be. So I would have.
Jordan, go ahead.
Fun fact, I actually turned 18 a couple days after Election Day, so I was not able to vote this year. But if I did have the chance, I think I would vote. However, I do think that it would be hard for me to make a decision on who I would vote for, only because the media has such a pull on everybody's bias, and it's hard to really figure out what would be true and what isn't, or what's going towards another person and opposing the other person.
Okay.
I agree with Jordan. Based on everything that I've seen in the media, it definitely would be hard to like decide who to vote for. But depending on what each person who's running campaign looks like, I would just go for who I think is best and who might solve problems that I want to stress the most.
Naye, did you want to chime in there?
Yeah, I would have definitely voted if I was turning 18 because I feel like there's not a lot of young people out here who's actually voting when they actually turn the age that they can vote, which is lowering who becomes president. I feel like with more young people voting once they're able to vote, it'll make a big impact. So yes, I would have voted.
Okay. So to Naye's point, that first statistic that I shared, that this 2020 election, there was an 8% increase in the 18-year-old and up category of those who voted. So say, for example, now, tomorrow, December 18th, the voting age now is 16. Several of you said that you maybe would have voted, but wouldn't have felt confident in voting. So now, tomorrow, the new voting age is 16. Would you be in favor of that change? And would you vote knowing everything you know now and where you are politically? Or would you wait until you were 20 in the next election?
I think I would vote, because me personally, I'm more in politics, and so I would be happy to vote, because then it's like, oh, I can finally have a say in the president or like that. The only thing is that I probably wouldn't be as confident in who like to choose, like, as like the other part of the voting. I would just probably be confident in probably like the presidents, and that's about it. So maybe I would still vote, but I probably after like who the president would be, after all of that, I would probably not even know what to choose. So yeah.
Okay. Margaret, what are your thoughts on that? If tomorrow the new voting age was 16, would you vote, or would you wait until you were 20? And if so, why? Or if not, also why? Do you think you would be prepared for that type of shift?
I might probably have to wait until I was 20, because I wouldn't be prepared. And I don't want to just go ahead and waste a vote like that, even though all votes matter and all votes are important, especially in this kind of situation. So I feel like I would wait and, you know, gain those extra years of wisdom and knowledge before I make a big decision like that.
Jordan,
I agree with Margaret. I think that I would wait until I was 20, because I'm not really into politics myself. So I don't think I would be able to make a decision like that. Although I do agree that every vote counts. I don't want to waste something where I'm unsure of who would be a better president.
So I'll go back to Antonio's statement about that every vote counts. And so Margaret and Jordan, you particularly use the word wasting a vote. Antonio, what are your thoughts on them feeling that it would be wasting a vote if they weren't fully informed and just didn't vote in general?
So the thing about wasting a vote, I think, like, when we think waste, we think that if we mess up, then that's considered like messing, like basically a failure, like we failed voting. So I guess I understand what they're saying when they mean miss a vote or mess up the voting or something like that. But I guess wasting a vote, like, it's not a thing, because as long as you vote, I think it's wasting if you're not voting. So in a way, even though you might not have voted like the right choice and it's late, I guess I wouldn't say that's a waste. So I understand, but I don't think it would be a waste. So that's what my thoughts are for what they said.
Aisha, I saw you nodding your head a little bit. Were you in agreement or just kind of pondering on what he was sharing?
Yeah, I was agreeing with what Antonio was saying. I don't believe you're wasting your vote, but I definitely believe that if you want to take the time to fully prepare for something as serious as that, then it's definitely something you should do. But personally for me, I would vote, because I've been keeping up with all the politics that has been happening, and I feel like I'm fully prepared to make a decision like that and, you know, possibly be a change. So, yeah.
So before we go to a quick team spotlight, I did want to at least start the conversation. How do you prepare? Like, how do you consume information now to feel like you would be ready for that decision? And Aisha, I guess since you kind of brought it up a little bit, maybe you can start by answering that question.
Yeah, so I just watch the news. I watch CNN, I watch Fox 5. I keep up with everything the president or both candidates have been talking about, all debates, and I just keep up with everything that they put out there, and also the problems and issues that have been happening in society, and I just compare them and see what each one will do to make our country better. So that's how I get prepared.
Okay, so Naye, how about you? You said, you also said that you would be ready and willing to vote. What are some of the ways that you feel like you have political power and are staying informed in order to make a decision?
So I watch the news a lot because of, like, my grandma and my mom and all of them, they watch the news, so I watch it with them. And so I hear a lot of, like, the perspectives of what's going on. Also, I kind of, like, if I see something, I'm like, oh, this doesn't sound right or something like that, I'll go to, like, a news source or I'll, like, look it up. I also, like, have friends who are also politically aware, and so I'll also go to them and ask if they've heard the same thing or something like that. Kind of how, like, I prepare and, like, understand things, because if I don't understand something, I feel like I can go to somebody else or I can look it up myself to figure out what's going on and understanding how everything is working. So, yeah.
So, I have really... Okay, one more question before I go to the spotlight. You brought up that you consume media and you consume news with your grandmother, and that's a different generation than you. All of you are Gen Z, right? Born after 1997. I'm a millennial, so I'm like right before you. So what role do you think that relationships with different generations can help in preparing you to make that decision if, you know, if that voting age were to switch?
I feel like it helps because, like, they've been here longer than us. So it's like, okay, they have more knowledge of politics than we do. So going to them and asking, I feel like they'll give us more knowledge. And they've been through other presidents. So knowing, like, what's happened with other presidents and how they've impacted us is, like, I feel like that's very helpful.
Okay. Antonio, did you want to add anything?
I totally wanted to add on to what she said. I agree. I definitely agree. They were there before the people who mean something to us. So they might have been there and seen things that we don't know about. So they might have seen a similar voting like the one that we had in November, and they might have known what was going on, or they could have told us how things went the time before it happened. So they could have already anticipated how things were going to come out or how things were going to look. But I think it is important to have to be around people who are older than us, because they're teaching us and we're not teaching ourselves. So I feel like we do need to be around people who are wiser and have more knowledge than all of us do. So, yeah.
All right. Yes, Aisha, and then we will use you as our spotlight transition.
Yeah, I'm excited for that. And I also wanted to agree with what Antonio said, but I also wanted to add that although people who are older than us are wiser and can teach us more about politics and how to maneuver around that, they might not fully understand, you know, like, what we know and how we perceive things to be, since we're in Gen Z, and they might see things a bit differently from how we see it. For example, Nancy Pelosi, she was born in 1940 and she's a House representative, and from someone who was born that long ago and it's 2020 now, I'm not 100% sure if they can fully grasp our perspective of things.
And on that, that is a great addition. So this part of the show is an opportunity to spotlight our teams. And so, as I mentioned earlier, you're going to get to know our co-hosts over the next year. So we wanted to use this opportunity to share with you a little bit of their talent in our team spotlights. right. So I have asked Miss Aisha Cisse to share her talent in spoken words. So Aisha, the floor is yours.
Thank you. I have a poem called Countdown, and it mostly talks about testing. So I'll just leave it at that. The light above the heads of the young adolescents shine as their pencils roam across their papers like wings of a bird flying high in the sky. Poor birds flying as high in the blue sky, never looking down in fear of falling. The students never looking up from their papers in fear of not finishing. Their smartness overtakes the overall aura in the room. The atmosphere is stiff with tension and suspense. The teacher has a timer of 30 seconds left on the clock. The student can hear the loud ticking of the clock and feel the harsh ache in their wrists. The determination instilled in the students numb the pain in their wrists and fingers. It numbs the blisters they endured and assures the fear they have deep inside. The peace they wish they can have once they finish will be terminated by the end of the timer. New anxiety will be replaced by the time duration of sitting and waiting for their scores, scores that will determine their life choices, careers, and paths. Many may pass, many may fail. It's funny how the fate of others depend on a paper and pencil. It's not always like that in some cases. It's contrast, but there's only one way to find out. Your time is up. Thank you.
Snap. Thank you, Aisha. And so any of our teens who are listening, if you'd like to be spotlighted in our next episode, be sure to get in touch with me, and I would love to have you in our next spotlight. All right, so let's continue on with the conversation. We have a few more minutes left in order to make sure that we are kind of getting all sides of this. So in the first half, we talked a lot about what makes a good conversation as it relates to not just politics, but talking with our fellow friends and our classmates. And then we transitioned into sharing about what would the world look like if there were a bunch of 16-year-old voters. Would you feel like you were ready? Would you feel like you were prepared? And what were some of the things that you would need to do in order to make that transition? So I wanted to ask a follow-up question to that, and it would be, do you feel that voting is the only way to exercise your power right now? So most of you are 15, Jordan, you're 18, but do you feel like voting is the primary way for you to be politically active? And if so, why? And if not, what are some of the ways that you can be active and involved right now where you're at? Margaret, I'll start with you.
Could you please repeat the question?
Yep. So what are some of the ways that you can be politically active right now where you're at? And do you think that voting is one of the only major ways to exercise your political power?
Okay, so before election week, my school gave us this little, not a petition, but they basically gave us the sign up where people that were 16 years old could sign up to help out with the elections, you know, the polls and things like that. And that, to me, that's one way to be active with the election. And mainly the main reason why 16-year-olds are taking care of that area is because of COVID and, you know, the older people. Yeah. So other ways to be engaged with the political aspect would probably be reading more books regarding politics, or, you know, reading magazines, listening to debates online, watching presidential conversations, anything that has to do with politics, basically. And what was the second question?
I think you answered it. Is voting the only way to exercise your political power? And then what are some ways that you can be politically active right now where you're at without being 18?
There are plenty of other ways to be politically active.
Okay, so Naye, what are your thoughts on that?
For the second question, yes, I feel like there's other things you can do to voice out your opinion. So like the social media, there's been a lot of young people starting marches and all that kind of stuff. There's like all those kind of things you can do. And what was the first question again?
And the first question was, is voting the only way to exercise your political power? Naye, did you want to answer it?
I'm sorry, I'm on mute. No, it's not. I feel like you can also, like, if you're very political and, like, since we're not the age to vote other than Jordan, I feel like we could, like, there's a lot of kids who go on social media and just, like, voice how they feel about each president, or even, like, just, like, you could even just read a book, like Margaret said. You can read a book. You can do a whole bunch of things to like to put out your political opinion without also being rude. So like if you feel like you're strongly with like a certain president, like you don't want to be rude, you could like put something to kind of like voice both presidents and kind of like put both perspectives, and also having a wider view on presidents and stuff, so that you won't be focused on one president. And stuff like that, yeah.
Jordan, I saw you unmute.
Oh, for the second part, in all honesty, I don't believe that voting is the only thing to do. If it seemed like I did agree with that, I'm sorry, that's not what I was trying to do. Things you could do, though, you could watch the news, you could read a book, but I do think an important thing is to remember that when you do watch the news, that sometimes they can be biased for certain people, especially with the media itself. There are a lot of biased opinions. So I think that you should really separate yourself from that and to really make your own decision rather than always listening to what other people say.
So as you three were sharing, you know, reading books and voicing your opinions on social media, how do you, and this is to wrap up our conversation, how do you shift from voicing your opinions and your perspectives to action? Because there are lots of opinions, there are lots of perspectives on things, there are lots of books on politics. So how do we move from consuming and projecting to actually being accountable to the things that we're consuming and we are projecting out on social media or other places?
I would say that's where it begins, verbally. I mean, you communicate and you start by watching a lot of things on the news, and then you go from verbal, and then you decide to take action. So yeah, I would say that's where it begins.
Okay.
I have two things to say. I wanted to answer the other one real quick. Voting as a family voting, due to like our ages, we can't vote, but I feel like if we would have families come together and study and see which politic helps out everyone, I feel like that could also be a way that we change how things go when we vote, and when we make sure our parents, when they do it, that it's the one everybody likes, everyone is okay with, the children, the mom, the dad, every person in that household. But to make an impact and to actually do something with what we're saying would be a community creating, like getting a group of people, start talking about what we can do to make things different, similar to what people do when they're on the streets and standing and going against what they are not for. I feel like creating a community would be how we take action.
Okay. Margaret or Naye, did you have any last thoughts to leave our audience with before we wrap up?
Yeah. I 100% agree with Antonio when he's talked about what he said first, like family voting, all for it, because I know like when my mom goes to vote, I definitely go with her because it like really gives you the experience of what to do and what not to do. Because I mean, I just feel like if I was like able to vote now, I probably would have probably told about voting and like who I was voting for out at the voting polls when you're really not supposed to. And I would have never known that if I didn't go with my mom. And what you said about like voicing your like how do you take action? I think like expressing how like what kind of president you will want or what kind of person you want in office will be an awesome way because that way like if there's a president who and like coming together with a whole bunch of people too like voicing like how you would want that person to be and how you would like want them to act and contribute because without people knowing that and without having people understanding what like we need for our community or the US, but it would be hard to like that's why there's so much conflict of what presidents are because we don't really know what we need and how we need it for each and individual person. So like if you don't know what we want for each and individual person, it's kind of hard to choose the right president or right senator.
Got you. Thank you, Naye. All right, so this wraps up our first episode. I know we had some technical difficulties, but we worked through it. So for those of you watching, Miss Sonia, Jill, Mr. Geddes, and Ryan, we will be on in January 2021. So our next episode will be January 7th, 2021, and we will be streaming on YouTube. So this podcast is sponsored by the LAFI, the Lake Arbor Foundation, and they have a great YouTube platform. So we will be amplifying our message and sharing it with not just only the Zoom room, but the World Wide Web. So join us in January 2021 at 7 p.m. Eastern Standard Time for our next episode of Teen Summit Podcast. It was a joy, and I hope that you all learned something new and are able to.